Welcome to The Catholic Forge, a conversational podcast where we gather to explore our Catholic faith and discuss how it forms our lives. All welcome to join in this conversation and journey. Thank you for listening.
Hey everyone, welcome to the show. This is Eric in Missouri.
And this is John in Illinois.
And we are under storm warning here. Did I mention that in the pre-show?
No, but we're having a little bit of rain here, but Eric and I are reunited after what seems like months. It was so good to see you come up on the screen. I saw the beard, and it was just like that first moment when you come home after a trip.
That is suitable for you to say, and thank you for saying so, because we're talking, if you didn't catch it from the title of the episode before you clicked on us, and thank you for clicking, we're talking about travel as a family, road trips, adventure. Now, Ben would be here, but he is having an adventure of another kind with, I don't even know. I mean, he left me a voicemail. The AC unit is exploding. I don't know. So we wish him well. Wish he was here. He was supposed to be, but got to take care of that drip, drip, drip first. But you and I have both been on the road recently.
Yeah.
I went to Cincinnati for a convention with and Tori and the kids spent that week in Lexington with her folks. And then we took an aeroplane to Oregon for a delightful week and a half for a vacation. And you have also been,
I've been around a little too. I took our church group to Wichita, Kansas, and we did a mission trip there in Wichita, which was quite delightful. It was 103. It was kind of like the average temperature while we were there. I drove the group back, and then the next day caught an airplane also to Texas, met up with my wife and the family in Texas, and then we began a month-long, what seemed that wasn't really a month-long, several-day trip back from Texas. And I just love the road. I've always just loved being out driving, and it's such an enjoyable thing. Even with all the kids, we got five kids in the car. You think it would just be miserable? It's just so enjoyable. Between my teenage years and my early 20s, I drove most of the country. I did quite a bit of driving with friends, and also by solo. Went quite a bit, and just would spend hours just loving it. And then when I went to Steubenville, you know, it was about a 10-hour drive. I drive the whole way. Mm-hmm. I didn't even have a working radio in the car. My brother would say, "How could you do that?" And I'd be like, "Oh, I wish it was twice as long." Just that that love of the road.
Sure.
However, when I did get a working radio, I thought, how did I ever do it before? But just that time, that solitude and the going forward, it's just awesome.
I wish that we had driven to Oregon. And that was my first pitch to Tori. I said, "Can we please drive?" And
she said, strike one.
She said, "I'm not driving." And I said, "No, you're right. I'll be driving."
Strike two.
But I think with where the kids are at, age-wise, you know, because it would have been 30 hours or so.
That's quite a haul.
But I think that what we had talked about, and it would have worked out with the time off and stuff, was we would have probably done like 5 days one way and then 4 or 3 days the next way. So quite leisurely getting there and then a little quicker getting back, but gone two different routes, you know, gone through the Central Pass and through the Southern, you know, passage, you know, returning. Anyway, I love the open road and road trips, especially in a country as geographically diverse as ours. Unbelievable I saw it in a really remarkable way. Even this last time we were driving from here in Kansas City to Lexington, but when I dropped Tori and the kids off before I went to Cincinnati for the convention, and sure enough, there's just something about when you cross over into the bluegrass, the way the hills immediately start to roll and the fields open up. And then, of course, you have the white and black picket fences for the horse farms and that kind of stuff. But just those shifts in geography are so moving, so beautiful. Oh, I couldn't imagine. And flying is efficient, but so costly. Everything
looks so boring from above. It's mesmerizing in the beginning, and then after a while, it's like, oh, more brown with little undulation, more brown. Even beautiful green areas up above, they don't look that green. And
It is cool to drive over like the breadbasket and to see the wheat fields. I mean, just go on and on. Flying into Portland, have you ever flown into Portland or Seattle or anything?
I have flown into Seattle.
Okay. Well,
driven from Seattle. I made that trek. I drove to Seattle. Well, I drove from Seattle back.
Ah, okay. Flying into Portland, you fly right by Mount St. Helens and or Mount Hood, one of those. But like you're in the mountains and then you're in just rolling, you know, high mountain evergreen forest. And then boom, it's like literally flying by the Lonely Mountain from The Hobbit, because there are no mountains unless you can see Mount Adams way in the distance, and then pow, there's this mountain right there. Oh my gosh, it's so beautiful. But you're right, otherwise flying could be whatever, and then stuck in that, you know, pressurized recycled air cabin. Oh boy. How did your kids do, you know, with the duration of that road trip?
You know, we've been doing trips to Texas quite a bit. We do them about twice a year. And so our kids have become quite accustomed from baby on. And so I think our kids travel pretty well. Our kids are pretty good. We definitely got kids better than either Cecilia or I were, and better than we deserve. So they're really pretty good travelers. You know, it's kind of a management thing, is just try to squeeze everybody at the same time when you get out for potty, and, you know, try to get everybody to go at the same time, because inevitably it happens. You'll stop for a potty break, and then you get back in the car 20 minutes down the road, the next kid's got to go.
Right.
But trying to manage those things. I think really, though, the trick to it is just being okay with the moment, and not putting that extra anxiety on yourself, being like, we got to get there, we got to get this. Because as in so much of life, the journey is just as important as the destination. And so that's what's so beautiful about a road trip. And it's something that we see historically as a huge part of faith. I mean, we see Jesus going on journeys, road trips all the time. I mean, right off we have, you know, him and his family. I mean, his birth, for heaven's sakes, is you know, Joseph and Mary are on a road trip when he's born, you know. And then the whole concept of that pilgrimage to Jerusalem, it's a real neat thing. And I think that's part of what I like about the road trip, is you're tapping into something that's part of the human fiber. This idea of doing a pilgrimage, that we're going on this journey, and it takes us out of our ordinary life. It takes us out of our ordinary circumstances. It presents adventures. And then there's this destination you're going to. And we see that it not only within our Jewish and Christian faith, but we see that even in other religions, this the importance of a pilgrimage. And in many ways, that's what it is. Unfortunately, sometimes the pilgrimage is to, you know, a water park or a theme museum or Disney, right. Disney World.
Yeah.
But I think it's satisfying some human desire there. I don't know. What are your thoughts on it kind of being part of a primal part of our religious, spiritual, human experience?
I absolutely agree. And we see that especially in art and other expressions of the human experience. And of course, I'm thinking of
The Walking Dead?
No. Oh, okay. Because you don't go anywhere in that show, John. You know, you're at the farmhouse for like 9 years.
Yes. Okay.
But I don't want to get started in that show. It's same with The Walking Dead again, with Game of Thrones, where the Army of the Dead takes 7 years to get to the wall. I don't want to talk about it. But I mean, of course, looking behind me at my, you can't see listening audience, but looking behind me, and I see my two sets of The Lord of the Rings. And the whole sense, someone jokingly said, it was a friend of mine who did not care for Lord of the Rings. They called it Board of the Rings. And they said,
I hope you unfriended this person immediately.
No, I love them. They're so funny. But they said that Fellowship of the Ring is no more than a glorified hiking guide through Middle Earth. Because I mean, he spends
But
probably
that's why I love it.
Exactly. He said he probably spends like a seventh of the book describing the geography, you know. But so much of that story is about the journey itself, the journey not only of the fellowship, but of all the little groups and all that kind of thing. And then so many of the stories that I love and cherish are about journey, sometimes voluntary, like the Fellowship of the Ring, sometimes involuntary, like the story of Ben-Hur. You know, of course, you know, because he is after he turns himself over for a crime he didn't commit, he is then forced. Well, his punishment is to be a slave rower in the gallows of a Roman whatever they call it, the
what
ship.
If that's how
you
my
know?
Children feel in the van.
That may be possible.
Pedal faster, run your feet faster. You know, we have the Flintstones vehicle that we take the floor out, and the kids run their feet, and we go.
There's something so compelling about that because we all see and feel that, and somewhere in our life, or even if you stayed in relatively the same place, which many people do, then you still see the progression of life and the journey of your existence, or the journey of your own understanding, you know, the journey of your feelings developing and changing with time. It's fascinating. And then, of course, we feel it in a special way when we actually do go, when we go get out of the house. And something that came to mind as you were speaking there was this sense of, I don't know that I would draw a line too quickly to the spiritual realm, but how when you're on the road, there's this sense of surrender, this sense of trust, not only in God always, but to the road itself. That is, you know, you're trusting that the next gas station will have gas, that the car will run, that the bed at the hotel will not have bed bugs, right?
I was thinking the same exact thing. It's funny you say that.
that all of these things will happen kind of as you hope they will and as you're theoretically planning. Are you a big, like, trip planner, or do you kind of, like, generalize?
I've done both. We have a very meticulously planned trip or vacation. But the way Cecilia and I do it now, we've left on vacation not knowing whether we were going to Montana or Colorado, and we made the decision when we got to the point where we had to turn north or south. Like, no. We had driven for 4 hours, and we knew we were going to go to the Grand Tetons National Park or Estes Park in Colorado for backpacking. So we had loaded up all our backpacking gear, and we were ready, and we had maps for both and trail guides for both, and we did not know where we were going until we were about 4 or 5 hours out, and we said, we're going to Montana. And we went to Montana.
Like you just knew, or like you flipped a coin? Or
no, we got there and we just listened to the road and went, that's the way we're going. And we went. and that's actually become kind of our model. We've loosened up, and I think that helps us with the kids, is that we're okay with the moment and kind of taking it where it leads us. And we play it by ear now, and you know, it's become so easy with our phones and stuff. You know, we'll be going along and the baby starts breaking down. All right, looks like we're going to be stopping the next half hour. We flip it out, look up hotels, get a few reviews, call ahead, and we're set. And it works really well. And actually, we've done that now for probably 7-8 years, where it's been real loose. I don't think we were ever crazy organized.
Yeah.
But we've got that freedom. And I, like I said, that relieves some of the anxiety, but it also makes us open to the moments that are at hand. And so we'll be driving along. You know, we went through Arkansas on our way back from Texas this time. Mm-hmm. We hit a diamond mine. If you've ever been there, it's very hot. We hit a diamond mine, and then we hit a quartz mine. And we did these different things, and we never really kind of knew where we were going to end up that night. And that gave us a great deal of freedom, because then we weren't racing against some kind of clock. And for me, there definitely is that spiritual sense. And I think part of it also is just retreat. And that you are outside your normal time, your normal space. And so you're given an opportunity while you're driving to reflect and to really do stuff. Whereas when I'm at home running around doing business, I've got the tyranny of the moment, the chaos of whatever's happening right now. I got to pick up the kids from school. I got to dinner. I got to do the dishes. I got to get this thing done for work. You know, when we're on this road trip, none of those constraints exist anymore. And so our mind is also freed to go on to, what do we want to, where do we want to see ourselves in 10 years? Where do we want to, and this is where the next place I'd go with this talk is, it is, if possible, imperative that families do these kind of things. They don't even have to be across the country or to Texas, things like that, but it is so important to have those times where you take yourself out of your normal moment so that you can reflect on, what are we as a family? Where are we going? You know, it gave Cecilia a chance and I to talk about, are we open to having another kid? You know, and of course we're always open, but are we going to actively pursue it?
Right.
Or where are we going to see ourselves in 5 years with a job? Or how do I get out of this podcast that just goes on and on with no listeners? You know, so it gives Cecilia and I a chance to really reflect on things. And then there are all kinds of little moments for us with the kids. You know, we'll stop at someplace and we'll get pizza and it'll be terrible. And, oh, this is the greatest pizza. And we'll have this great memory, and like months later Michael will be like, can we go back to that pizza place that was really awful? And I'll be like, why do you want to go back there? Because I was with you. You know, and so it's so important. And of course it doesn't have to be accomplished through road trips, but it's a unique event that can happen, because, and of course we don't have cell phones in the car for the kids, so they're uniquely in tune to us and being forced. There's no, well, I want to go watch TV. Well, tough. There isn't a TV, you know.
Yeah.
So
yeah, sure.
It really is a wonderful experience, that. And I think that there's a great value, and really encourage families to take time for vacation as that opportunity to get out.
Hmm. I would like to confirm, first of all, that my mom does listen to the show. I
don't mean to always insult our listeners. I know that there are many of you out there. It's just a fun, it's a way to poke fun of ourselves.
It was funny because she said, John, I always don't listen to the show, but I do. But, you know, and so she does.
Thank you, Eric's mom.
And I was so pleased to get to share the podcast with some people in person. My friend Katie, longtime friend, didn't even know it existed. And so I told her about it, and she subscribed right there on iTunes in front of me. You can do the same, by the way. We'll talk about that later. And my mom even had some suggestions for episode topics, which I'll throw past you, John, later. But it was wonderful to get to share those things. You mentioned, I mean, like talking with Cecilia. Do you like listen to things together, or mostly just talk, or like is the radio on, or audiobooks, or podcasts, or what?
You know, it's a varied smorgasbord, so it's hard to say one thing. We don't listen to music a lot. We both love music and have quite large music collections, but when we're on the road trips, I notice we don't quite listen to the music very often. We do spend a lot of time talking. We will listen to podcasts and different things. Sometimes we'll listen to something, you know, that's faith development kind of thing, like a CD, or the Lighthouse Media, which I'd love to give a plug for. You know, they've got wonderful little CDs or downloads and podcasts that you can listen to in the car. So we'll listen to those.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
But I'd say for the most part, it's kind of radio silence. There isn't, at least with our last couple trips, that maybe is a tenth of our trip has got that kind of stuff going. The most of the time is either quiet or us in conversation, you know, and we'll have a long drawn out conversation too, where we'll talk and then it'll be 10 minutes of silence, and then we'll talk again about the same thing, because we're able to really spend that time to really have a deep thought about something. So she can say something and I can really ponder it for a while, and then I can respond, and it's not awkward because she's sitting there waiting for 10 minutes. We're also on the road trip, and so it's a unique kind of conversation that we can have too. It's not necessarily 10 hours of listening to me babble, but it's a real unique form of conversation, as I already said.
Two things. One, there's an app called Road Trippers. Check it out the next time you, as in you, John, or you, the listener, are on a road trip. And there's also Road Trip America. And you punch in your route, okay? And it will tell you all these weird things to do along the way. Like, here you may see the nation's largest replica of John Adams made of butter. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Like little zany things. But it'll also tell you, like, here's where you can eat, and here's you can stop for hotels. It It is the new version of what MapQuest used to be, kind of, where you'd go in and punch it out and print it off, and it was like 25 pages long because it had every single turn that you took, you know, before we had smartphones. And so check that out. Just so if you want to enliven your road trip a little bit, like John said. So then that way it was going to tell you in 66 miles, there's a quartz mine, and then it'll bring up the reviews right there. Check it out, yes or no. Two, we were driving around my hometown in North Bend, Oregon. And I asked Tori, I said, do you think it's our destiny to return here? And it was just us. We were going to see a movie. We saw Dunkirk. Have you seen that, John?
No, but I very much would like to see it.
We really got to talk about that. We will have an episode just for Dunkirk. Just fascinating. Anyway, we're going to see the movie. I said, do you think it's our destiny to return here to get as far away from John as possible in the contingent United States? And we kind of talked about it. And we talked about destiny. We talked about predestination and free will and all that kind of stuff. And so we're talking as we're getting to the movie theater, walking in, still talking about it, get to the counter, order the tickets, get the large popcorn and the large Diet Coke.
And your ex-girlfriend was behind the counter.
No, wouldn't that be delightful? And consequently, I've started getting, I should stop immediately, but I get half regular Coke and half diet, you know, and so I'm ordering. And then I notice, remember how the conversation started? Is it our destiny to move back to North Bend? And the name of the young woman serving us, Destiny, right there on her name tag. And I said, now, Tori, if we were predestinationists, this would be a sign. And it kind of made me feel a little uncomfortable that we were talking about it. This is our destiny. And there was destiny right in front of us. We're not moving back. Okay.
Yeah, but half the women in Oregon are named Destiny anyways.
They're named like Ember or something like that, as in E-M-B-E-R, you know? Oh my gosh. It was a wonderful time home. Now, actually those were just addendums to my craziness.
Yeah, what was the point of that? How did that fit into the podcast?
I just wanted to say things.
Thank you, Destiny. Your service was very valuable.
Yes.
Please subscribe.
But I think I would say that we talk about that often, just like you said, you and Cecilia do, but there was something about being alone, you know, far away, that there was a certain comfort with that kind of conversation. And not because you're in the place that you're talking about, but just being on a trip together, it was just a very, very splendid moment for us to be able to broach that topic openly and honestly. And I mean, like I said, we talk about it anyway, like, where are we going to go next? Are we going to, you know, do we want to stay here forever? And, you know what I mean? Respectfully speaking, relatively speaking, you know, what's kind of the 5-year plan? What's the 10-year plan? Just like you said with Cecilia. I only say that so that if our bosses listen to this,
they aren't wise to our plans to bail.
Yeah, then I think we're not planning our graceful exit.
I do find that to be one of the most enjoyable things about a road trip with another person, especially with my spouse now, is to be able, it presents so many opportunities to explore areas of our life that we just aren't a normal part of conversation. Or if I were to bring them up, she'd be like, what's wrong? Did you get fired today? Or, you know, like, it's just things that we just aren't normally present to us are possible to talk about.
Agreed. I was just wondering. I was trying to think of a curious or a clever hypothetical question to ask you, maybe to kind of wrap this up here. Something related to travel. Can you think of anything clever? I don't know. I was thinking about this today too, just kind of as I was preparing for this episode and thinking, if you could take a road trip with three other people, I mean, or if you could travel to one place in the world, where would you go and who would you go with and that kind of thing? Well, I think that's a reasonable question, and I mean, this doesn't really reflect back to any of those deeper sentiments, but if your brood, if abuela would come and watch the kids and you and Cecilia could go anywhere in the world, where would you go?
I think it'd be Fiji or Guam.
Really?
Yeah. I love the oceans. I love the tropical environments, all the plants, all the life. But also, you know, you have some mountains there too. And it's just the combination of all of the wonderful things, you know, these like, you know, a tropical island like that where you've got mountains. So none of these flat little like sandbed islands, but something
right.
beautiful, you know. Not that the little Caribbean islands that are kind of flat are bad. They're lovely too. But you get mountains, you get oceans, you get tropics. You can't go wrong.
Did you honeymoon there in the tropics?
We did. We got to go to the Virgin Islands for our honeymoon. And then we went to Puerto Rico also like 2 years after we were married as kind of our last vacation before we had children.
Right.
Cecilia was quite pregnant with Joe and we're like, we better go somewhere and do something before we have the kids. And then, of course, we found out our kids travel well. So it worked out.
So do you think that there's any kind of big trip in the works with the kids, or
we do quite a few big trips. They're all landlocked ones, though. You know, we drove to Connecticut, and then we drove up the East Coast last year through Maine, and got pretty close to Canada, and visited the ocean there quite a bit.
Oh, wonderful.
Cecilia loves the mountains too, so we've gone to Colorado, Montana, and Estes Park with the kids, and we got the backpacks that you put the kids in, and it's just wonderful. We go up. We were going up the mountain one time, and I had Joe in my backpack, and I'm up there going, and Cecilia was pregnant, and she's walking behind me, and this couple comes down the other way, and she looks at us, and she goes, "You're so brave." And I'm thinking, she's talking about me with this awesome kid in the backpack, and I'm going, and then I realize she's looking at Cecilia, because Cecilia was very visibly pregnant, and she's just marching along, going up the mountainside, and I was like, she's talking to my wife.
She's
carrying the baby close to her front. I'm carrying it up high and precariously on my back. I want the credit, but I didn't get it. But so we've gone on some spectacular trips, and none of them are expensive trips. You know, we're camping along the way. We're very thrifty people, and don't have and driving a lot of time is because we just couldn't afford the airfare for everybody to fly somewhere. So it goes well, and we've done quite a bit of trips, and I'm quite content with those trips. I don't feel like I need to go to a runaway to a tropical island to really have it. But if I could, I wouldn't mind it. What about you? Where's your ideal?
If we had a couple weeks, let's say, I would love to go with Tori to Italy and into the Vatican and the holy places and that kind of thing.
Yes.
And then spend time in Europe, just doing the European thing.
I think that might be superior to just hanging out in Fiji.
We looked at all that for the honeymoon, like doing the resort and all that kind of stuff, which now looking back on it may have been superior to what we did do for our honeymoon, only because, if you really want to experience that lap of luxury, these all-inclusive packages are just so such a treat, you know. And granted, you kind of have to stay on the premises, this massive premises, the whole time.
It sounds a little decadent to me.
Yeah, it depends on what you want to do. Like, if you just want to sit on the beach and read Aquinas, that's probably what you want to do, you know. But if you want to adventure, then it would depend where. Anyway,
the Holy Land would be one of the prime places, I think, that I would like to travel. I'm never really likely to travel to Fiji, but I do think the Holy Land is some place that I really would like to travel to. My mother just came back from the Holy Land. She had always wanted to go, and so she went on a trip with a priest, and just phenomenal stories. It just made me so envious, but it was so amazing to see the pictures and hear the stories. And of course, you hear that from everyone that has gone to the Holy Land, just to see the places where Christ was and talked. It's just this altering experience that gives such life to scriptures.
You should ask your mom if she would come on the show and talk about it. I would love to hear that. Did you listen to the episode about the body images episode that Ben and I recorded?
No, I have not.
At the end of it, I pitched an idea, and I want to throw it out again to you. And Tori has mentioned it before, and like a fool, I endorsed it and said I would do it as well. I would love it if you and Cecilia, not Abigail, you and Cecilia and Ben and Alice and Tori and I did the Camino de Santiago.
I would be delighted. That would be incredible.
And we have a priest friend. You know who he is.
Yes.
Who leads pilgrimages on the Camino.
Yeah.
And they only do like 75 miles of it, not the whole freaking 500 where you got to walk through the Alps. No, thank you.
Cecilia and I will start there. We'll catch up with you.
Yeah, maybe. I would love that. You know, if there was ever a way that the six of us could go together.
Well, and maybe we could do that as one of our... the Catholic Forge, we could take a pilgrimage then the second time. So we would be doing a test run the first time, and then we would open it up to the public, and we could lead a pilgrimage, and we could give talks along the way. And
sure, yeah.
I could lead Bible studies. And
oh, of course. I've seen so many friends go and do varying lengths of it. I mean, obviously, the terminus is the same, but where do you start from, different times of the year? And indeed, it just... You know, it has such a draw because of St. James, but you know, just in general for its, and granted, it's popular right now. So I'm not trying to buy into the fad, but Tori was already kind of thinking about it.
Well, and it's been there for hundreds, thousands of years, so it's not a fad. It's
well, but, you know what I mean. Like yeah. It is from it was the movie The Way. Was it called? And then it kind of blossomed in people knowing about it and that sort of thing. So, we can talk to Father about that too, because he leads pilgrimages now.
He's just leading a group of 80 is what it came down to. Yep. It started out as a small group, and then last time I talked to him, it was 80.
Oh my gosh. How many did you take to Wichita?
We took 50 this year, which is one of our smaller groups.
Just as we wrap up, but I mean, I think that for some of the listeners who've never been on like a mission trip of that scale or been engaged with the Catholic heart work, you don't have to describe that. They can go Google for it. But speak to that. What was it like traveling with these young people and the experience of all that?
This one was quite easy because it was a little smaller than normal. The last couple of years, we've been doing 70 and 80 people. We've been taking on a mission trip. So 50 was a lot more manageable. It's a really neat experience to take a group of young people, many of them who've not had much travel experience, out of their known world or their realm of where they're comfortable. Travel it took us about 12 hours to go, and that's a long car ride with a number of people and traveling. And so you learn a lot about the people in there, about their tolerances, about their personality, about how people deal with stress, and how it just is really awesome people watching experience. But it's so cool to see the growth in that, because everyone's uncomfortable after 12 hours of sitting in a car and going. And then, of course, when we go on a mission trip, we're sleeping on floors in a classroom, and we're going out and we're working during the day, and it's hot and sweaty. Like I said, it was 103. You're going out and you're doing strenuous work in the heat and the sun. And then you go to bed, and in the early morning, you get up to do it all over again. And it's just so, I think the most exciting thing about it is we will be in the worst, most miserable conditions that you could imagine. And the teens and the people that we're with will say, "This is awesome. I love this. This is the best week of my life." And it's so contrary to what should be their experience.
Right.
It is incredibly hot. They're getting sunburned. They're getting bug bites. They're sleeping on a hard floor. It should be miserable. But regularly, this was amazing. This is the best week of my life. I can't wait to come back next year. And that's such an awesome and awe-inspiring experience for me to see that. There's so much lack of faith in the youth, and then you see them do something like that. It just is just wonderful, because you get to see how when we are pouring ourselves out with purpose, when we're pouring ourselves out for Christ, and that's what we're there for. We're there to serve Christ's people. And many of the people we're serving, probably very few of them, if any of them, are Catholic. Many of them are not Christian. But they are God's children. And we are there to love them because Christ loves them, and to love them as they are, and to serve them, you know, because we are serving Christ. And as Mother Teresa would say, you know, we have to see Christ in everyone. And so they're pouring ourselves out for them, and how that transforms the young people that are doing it, the gift of self, to see them give that. And so that's just what is so wonderful about the trip.
Yeah.
And makes it all manageable. So no matter all the miseries that you think it could be of taking 80 people across the country in the heat, it's very doable. It's just a wonderful experience. So a different type of road trip, but one of great effect.
And it echoes back exactly to what you said right at the beginning of the show, that so often the journey to the destination can be just as valuable as what you do at the destination itself. That, like you said, for these young people, there's a galvanizing in their minds that yes. both go together. It's not, oh, we hated getting there, and then once we were there, we loved it, and we hated getting back. I don't think you're hearing that at all. And they're seeing that very, you're right, that very ancient gene DNA sense of how integral the journey is with the actual experience of going and doing. And so certainly we admonish you, you know, if you haven't taken a road trip in a while, go.
Take your family.
Go, and you don't have to go far. Get on TripAdvisor, get on Road Trippers, you know, find a place near you that looks fun, or just go. This has been the Catholic Forge. Thank you for listening. We'd like to close, as always, with a prayer and a blessing. May God the Father, God the Son,
and God the Holy Spirit bless you, guard you, and lead you to eternal life. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you for listening to the Catholic Forge. We hope you enjoyed this episode and will leave us a positive rating and review on iTunes, SoundCloud, and YouTube. And you know, Katie, the friend who subscribed right there, she said, should I leave you a good review? I said, yes. Listen to the show first and judge for yourself. But that really does help us when you leave that solid review. Thank you. Thank you. You can continue the conversation, and please do, with us on Facebook and Twitter. And to get a hold of us, reach us at our email, thecatholicforge@gmail.com. For more information, check out our website, www.thecatholicforge.com. We especially thank our traveling wives. Where they go? Tori, don't leave. I don't know where they went, but they're traveling. We thank them for their support of this project, and we thank you very much for listening.